Welcome, everyone, to Rupp Arena, the SEC on ESPN. Holiday Hoops presented by Kay Jewelers as Marshall Thundering Herd taking on the Kentucky Wildcats from Rupp Arena in Lexington. This is the 12th meeting all time between these two teams. Marshall comes in with a record of 7-5. There's a look at their starting lineup. They have started three different point guards in their last three games. The starter tonight is going to be Tamron Manning along with D.D. Scarver in the backcourt. For Kentucky, Goodwin, Mays, Harrell, Poitras, and Nerlens Noel, one of the top shot blockers in the country, in the middle. John Calipari, the head coach in his fourth season of the defending national champions, a young team still searching for exactly who they are and what exactly they're going to hang their hat on this year. Meanwhile, the head coach for the Thundering Herd, Tom Herrien, in his third season on the sidelines, former associate head coach at Pitt. His team coming in at 7-5. Look at our officials today. Mike Nance, Patrick Evans, and Chuck Jones. I'm Mark Jones alongside Carol Lawson. And we are set and ready to go. The Kentucky Wildcats, Carol, in the middle of a three-week homestand. You talk about home cooking and getting a chance for a young team to do some team bonding.
Well, when you look at the schedule, Mark, I mean, this is their first game, or I should say they've only had one game in the last 2 weeks, so a lot of practice time for this group to try and get their combinations under control. And you see Ryan Harrow, he's in the starting lineup for the second straight game. Him getting back into the flow as a point guard has been huge for the Cats offensively.
He is firing away from downtown, missing the three. The putback good by Alex Poitras.
We'll see extension of pressure from Kentucky early. It's one of the things they've been working on. Then when you couple that with the fact that three different point guards in the last three games started for Tom Herrien and Marshall, they need to take care of the basketball.
Covering her going inside for Dennis Tinnen. Couldn't find the handle out of bounds, though. Off of the Wildcats, it'll be Marshall basketball underneath. 19 on the shot clock. Marshall, a team that has dealt with its share of injuries early in the season. Some of their best players out of the lineup. The steal by Noel. Harrell on the break and the layup. The NC State transfer, who missed several games earlier this year because of a mysterious upper respiratory infection, still rounding into form. On the baseline, Pittman. Pittman, junior college transfer, one of the pleasant surprises. Lost it, then got it back. I'll just call that a pass. Garrett Spikes for the alley-oop slam. Andrew Spikes out of Fort Lauderdale with the game's first bucket for Marshall.
Already on the last two possessions, you see how Noel impacts the game. I mean, he gets the poke-away steal, and there he altered that shot. It just was a fortuitous throw there for the Thundering Herd.
Cross-court pass to Goodwin, thought about it. Marshall zoning up here a little bit.
And the key for Kentucky, I mean, they saw some zone in their last game against Lipscomb, not being stagnant and flashes coming in a timely fashion there.
With only three on the shot clock. Mays missing, Noel foul, taking it back to the basket by Nigel Spikes. And Nerlens Noel, the number one player in the class of 2012, as per Paul Biancardi and ESPNU last year. He'll go to the free throw line for a pair. The foul against Spikes, his first.
We've already seen two opportunities on the offensive end for Kentucky. Offensive rebounds. Poitras comes in, gets the offensive board. There Noel does. It's what Tom Herrien was worried about at shoot around. He said, defending the first shot, but we can't allow them. They're so good at quick jumping and getting back and getting a second opportunity at the basket. So Marshall's first shot defense has been pretty solid. They got to check out on the glass.
Especially Noel, who leads Kentucky in rebounding, as well as steals and block shots. The 54% free throw can knock down both. here at Ruff Arena.
Yeah, a little 2-2-1 pressure here from Marshall. Just kind of delay and disrupt, trying to force Kentucky to take something off the shot clock.
Almost got the turnover, too. Harrell says, look what I found. That's a nice feed from Poitras. Marshall with their defensive coordinator calling out signals from the bench. Long jumper from the wing, no good by Tinnen. And back comes Kentucky. Good transition defense that time, though, by Marshall.
And that's what they have to do. And so much of your transition defense is also the quality of shot that you take. And so Marshall needs to be careful that they're taking great shots on the offensive end.
Scarver takes it in and one. As D.D. Scarver will have an opportunity for a three-point play. Hit a game-high 18 against Savannah State in their last game, and he's their leading scorer coming in.
You look at D.D. Scarver and Elijah Pittman, the two young men that have been at the free throw line on consecutive possessions. They've been solid contributors. Good surprises for Tom Herrien out of junior college. And he said, look, we recruited these guys. We knew they needed to come in and play right away, not ease their way in, and they certainly have done that.
Now just a one-point game. Wilcher checks into the ball game for Kentucky. Three-point shooter showing signs of breaking out of his recent slump. Jumper from the wing by Mays off the mark. Rebounded by the Thundering Herd, and they're looking to push a little bit here. Scarver with the pull-up way off the mark. That comes Ryan Harrell. Calipari stomping on the sidelines emphatically. Well, whatever it was he said, it worked. Still didn't look too pleased on the sidelines, though.
It has been a constant battle for John Calipari to get his guys to play with the energy level, the communication level that he demands. And, you know, you see this group, and Ryan Harrell as a point guard, I mean, he needs him to step up with his energy.
Elijah Pittman nails the three, and we're tied at 10 apiece. Pittman, a dead-eye three-point shooter, right at 40% on the season.
He's Pittman the guy you're talking about practicing his
home run shot after later. Morrell inside, counters to the Wildcats. He's got four. That's the part of Merlin's Noel's game that John Calipari told us a little bit earlier this afternoon, Kara, is improving his offensive repertoire.
Well, he's improved. I mean, he's really a guy that is fantastic on the defensive end, but in terms of finishing when it's not a dunk, when it's a post move or a one-on-one isolation, Noel has some work to do there.
He changed the shot that time with Manning. Wilcher looking for the dribble handoff, well denied by Pittman. Harrell on top. He's going to look at the half-court poise for Kentucky. Goodwin fires away. And good hustle by Marshall to come up with a loose ball. They got a two-on-one. And a foul as Scarver went to the cup. Interesting, Curry. What'd you make of Pittman flaring out to the three-point line on that fast break? A two-on-one.
Well, you know, I thought they were so close. I thought they were narrow. So the opportunity to create that two-on-one, he didn't run around on top of it, but he just hit one. I mean, Pittman just hit one, so he's feeling good. Sometimes you run to the line, but I like Scarver's attack here. You make the defender make a play, and he certainly makes Julius Mays foul in there.
I've watched you get your jacks up. You'd run to the three-point line,
too. I'd run to the three-point line, too. That's right, especially if I hit my first one.
A timeout on the floor, and Calipari talking about his young team. In fact, the player with the most minutes at Kentucky returning this year actually comes off the bench. That's Kyle Wilcher. So really underscores how they have to start over from year to year. And of course, it's nothing new at Kentucky with the abundance of one and done players that move on to the next level.
Just seeing that, you know, winning the national championship a year ago and six players drafted and a complete start over. Now, does John Calipari have a ton of talent? Absolutely. Is the ceiling high for this team? Absolutely. But there is a lot of work for him to get this group from point A to point B. And that's why this time, exams after exams, when the other students are home on the winter break, this is a great teaching opportunity and a chance for his group to improve.
Telling us a little bit earlier about Camp Cal, as it's become affectionately known in these parts. This time of the year, they get a chance to spend extra time together, and they do three-a-days, although not three-a-days in the vigorous physical sense of the three-a-day meaning. Sometimes it's a little stretching in the morning and a movie or team bonding session at night. Although, theoretically, it could be three hard workouts, too. Depending on the mood of the head coach.
Yeah. That's one of the reasons, you know, we're so anxious to see Kentucky play today, because of the fact that they've done a lot of growing, done a lot of improvement over the last 2 weeks. One game in the last 2 weeks. So it's been an opportunity for them to build their chemistry, build the relationships they have with one another, and continue to iron out some of those combinations. And you talked about Wiltshire coming off the bench. He comes off the bench against Lipscomb and has a career high in both points and rebounds. Shot the ball well, so certainly lit a fire under that young man.
Scarver knocks down one of two, an 83% free throw shooter. And Marsha back to within one. Who do you figure the pace is favoring so far,
well,
if anyone?
I like what Marshall's doing with their extension of that 2-2-1. We'll see Wiltshire get off the three. I like the fact that they're making Kentucky work before they get it over the timeline, and that seemed to have disrupted the rhythm a little bit. Kentucky's got to find a way to get the ball on the inside against that zone. They can't have a steady diet outside jumpers.
As soon as Poitras came into the game, he'll come back out with his second personal foul. Julius Mays back in for him. Poitras, Mr. Basketball in the state of Tennessee last year. ESPNU, top 10 recruit. Martin up court. Chris Martin, six-footer. Sophomore from Upper Marlboro for three, way off, rebounded and blocked by Mays, right to Pittman, hesitated and subsequently missing. There's Polson with the dribble handoff to Mays. Wiltshire inside. He's talked so much about his improved inside game. Goodwin slashing and he misses. Comes Marshall with a chance to take the lead. Scarver in a rush and the finger roll.
How good has Scarver been in transition? He's really been on the attack. That's his second layup. He got to the free throw line. He understands that Noel, the big fella, is not quite down there yet in transition. He can get a clean look at the rim.
It'll be interesting there to watch Wiltshire's minutes, because Calipari told us that he's got to be more than just a shooter. And if he does just make shots, then even that's going to limit his minutes.
Absolutely. I mean, the danger that Kyle Wiltshire needs to stay away from is not to be a statue on either end of the floor. He can't just be content to stand outside the three-point line and shoot shots. And he has to improve defensively. He has to improve on the defensive end in containing penetration.
Goodwin, meanwhile, fouled on the drive. The foul goes against Chris Martin. That's his first. Goodwin in the line for two. All right, thanks a lot, guys. Welcome to the SEC on ESPN. Holiday Hoops, presented by K. Jewelers. On Kentucky from Rupp Arena in Lexington, Kentucky. Mark Jones courtside along with Kara Lawson. This is the 12th meeting all time between these two teams. Kentucky winning the previous 11. And you're looking at former high school All-American Archie Goodwin at the free throw line for the young Wildcats. His first 2 points of the ball game, giving Kentucky a one-point lead. Kentucky comes in on a three-game winning streak. Marshall, meanwhile, at 7-5 overall.
Marshall's done a nice job in the early going, disrupting Kentucky's rhythm on the offensive end. The only thing that Kentucky has really gotten going for them on the offensive end is on the glass. They've been able to create some extra opportunities.
Whistle and a foul on the play. Fouls against Kyle Wiltshire, who we were speaking about just a few moments ago, and trying to be a little bit more impactful at the defensive end. That sends Dennis Tinnett to the free throw line, the 6'8 senior from Green Bay, Wisconsin, coming off a 14.6 rebound performance in his last game. Knocks down the first.
We talked about high expectations for Kentucky starting the year, of course, the number three team in the country, but there's a lot of high expectations for Marshall coming into the year as well, and certainly the non-conference has not gone as planned for Tom Herrien. A mixture of injuries and guys in and out of the lineup. They're missing DeAndre Kane and will miss him for the next few games. And that's a big part of their offense, averaging about 8.5 assists a game for the guard.
He's arguably the best player. Here's Wiltshire over the midcourt line. Marshall leading by one. Seen a lot of this Thundering Herd zone in the early going. And a nice bucket underneath by Cauley Stein.
Cauley Stein is a guy that John Calipari is looking to get more minutes. He's got a live body. He runs the court very, very well. An exceptional athlete. It's just his skill on the offensive end that needs to continue to grow.
Pittman with the rip move. Good ball fake, losing the handle. And it's Kentucky basketball. This is the danger for Marshall. As they talked about not opening up the floor for Goodwin and his Wildcat teammates. He got one in early transition there, and now that's 4 points for him.
See, I think Kentucky, sorry, Mark, I think Kentucky can look to push the pace even more. As we see Starver, and he's playing well. Even after a make here, I think if they run it up the court like this, it gives them their best opportunity on the offensive end. They don't have to fight the zone.
Marshall continuing to get back in defense. Mays left wide open. Rims out. Wiltshire with the tip, no good. And controlled by the Thundering Herd. Pittman leaking out. And the slam at the other end. He's got the flaps down. And the Thundering Herd are taking flight as Kentucky calls timeout. Is he talking about a little bit of floor balance, Kara? What do you think?
Transition defense, and that's been inconsistent for Kentucky all season long. When someone takes a shot, there's got to be a player back. And there it looks like it might have been Julius Mays who missed the assignment, but you cannot allow easy baskets like that if you're Kentucky. You know, he talked about how pace is so important for this group, and they're at their best in transition. I mean, when you look at the makeup of this team, the fact that Noel and Cauley Stein are so good, I mean, they're thoroughbreds. I mean, we are in Kentucky, right? I mean, they're thoroughbreds running up and down the basketball court. Harrow, Goodwin, they can be electric in transition. Wiltshire, as that trail post, can hit the three. They have to look to push on every opportunity and not try to slog through a half-court execution game.
Perry telling us that it might be until February where they really start to get some traction and understand who they are and what they want to do. Coming out of the timeout, Marshall leading by a pair. Well underneath, nowhere to go. Now forced into half-court offense again, Wiltshire. Almost knocked away from Cauley Stein. Harrow with a nice dime inside. Look, Marshall getting a lot of deflections, Carroll. Time winding out on the shot clock, and Harrow gets the floater to go.
And that's what Harrow can do, and they've missed some of that. The fact that he can just be a little bit slippery there into the zone. Nice job getting the floater.
And Pittman injured himself on that last sequence. Timeout on the floor with 11:03 to go in the first half. Pittman going to be tended to in the locker room.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K. And Chevrolet and their award-winning cars, trucks, and crossovers.
And welcome back, everyone, to the SEC on ESPN. It's Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers. As the Marshall Thundering Herd face the Kentucky Wildcats under the lights here at Rupp Arena in Lexington, Kentucky. A place that has been a bastion of success for the Wildcats throughout the years, and now under the direction of John Calipari, head coach of the defending national champs. Look at that record, 56-1. That one lost recently against Baylor. Pierre Jackson and crew coming in here and running away with the W. 11 minutes to go here in the first half. Chris Martin bringing the ball up court. Pittman and Scarver doing a lot of the heavy lifting But the bad news for Marshall is that Pittman went into the locker room a few moments ago to be attended to by the athletic trainer. Shot way off the mark by Martin. Put back no good. It'll be Kentucky basketball.
Kentucky needs to find a way to find some rhythm on the offensive end. I mean, Marshall has been consistent in this first half. This 2-2-1, three-quarter court zone, back to 2-3 or 3-2. There they find an open look.
Wiltshire had it rattle in and out. There's Scarver on the move. Martin now, guarded by Harrell. And good active hands by Carly Stein. Harrell missing. Goodwin couldn't get his hands on the rebound. And the track meet is on in racehorse country. Martin with the jumper. Out of bounds. And it's Kentucky ball. Hey, Holiday Hoops presented by Kay Jewelers continues here on ESPN2 following this game with a double dip being played in the state of Missouri. At 6 in St. Louis, Phil Pressey and Missouri taking on Brandon Paul in Illinois. Then at 8, we go cross-state to Kansas City as Kenny Boynton and number 8 Florida take on Kansas State. That's all following the conclusion of this game at 6 Eastern here on ESPN2, also live on Watch ESPN.
Can't wait for that Missouri-Illinois
yes.
game.
Harrell. Goodwin driving. Tough shot. Or was it a pass? Whatever it was, it didn't quite work out, Carroll. Kentucky being forced to play a methodical half-court game. Scarver with a contested jumper. Missed everything. Mays. Harrell feeling it and still in knockdown mode.
You see that? That wasn't even a transition basket. But because they pushed it up, they had great timing. They had great energy. They had great speed on their cuts, and that opened up the three-point shot for Harrell. I just think Kentucky's got to flow into things. They can't walk it up.
That was Kentucky's first three-pointer of the ballgame. Under 9 minutes to go in the first half. They throw it inside to Tinnen, and he walked with it.
Well, that's the size of Collie Stein and the athleticism. Tinnen not wanting to get a shot blocked. And yes, there are times like this, a dead ball situation, where you have to walk it up. But any time, even on a made shot where you have to take it out, you don't have to resign yourself to the fact that you have to slow it down.
Poitras with the ball. Noel, they really lay off of him. They dare him to shoot, Garrett. Goodwin tried to find Noel on the two-man game and throws it out of bounds.
Well, Tom Herrien called it pinching, and that's clogging up the middle. So anytime a player's guarding Noel or Collie Stein, they're going to slough off. They're going to try and clog off the middle, clog off the penetration gaps for Poitras and Goodwin because they are confident that Noel can't beat them from the outside.
Goodwin with the steal. And he missed the layup. Nigel Spikes with good hustle to get back and at least bother him a little bit. Inside. Tinnen. Well, he's having a tough time on the offensive end. Hayes on the move. Back out to Harrell. Emphatic Calipari on the sidelines calling out the half-court set. That's going to be a palming violation against Harrell. Another Kentucky turnover. Maybe fewer turnovers, one of the items on Coach Cal's holiday wish list. We'll find out exactly what they are on the other side. Welcome back, everyone. Holiday Hoops presented by Kay Jewelers. Kentucky with a tenuous three-point lead, just under 8 minutes to play here in the first half. I'm Mark Jones courtside along with Carol Lawson. Let's take a look at Coach Calipari's Christmas wish list. What if Santa Claus is going to deliver on any of those, Carol? What do you figure? Growing as a team. He had some interesting things about talking about giving back in the community, something that he really stresses with his team. And I'm not sure about number 3. That's a tough one.
I mean, how many people around the country think he should get a magic wand? He's got Noel and Willie Cauley-Stein and Archie Goodwin and Alex Poitras as we take a look at Tom Herrien's wish list as well.
Coach Cal got himself a
Isn't that the magic wand? Wasn't it already
players.
Waved?
Yeah. Pittman back in the ballgame. Harold, tough pass. Kyle Perry telling Harold, hey, pump the brakes a little bit as Poitras comes back out of the ballgame. Willie Cauley-Stein, an interesting story for Kentucky. Number 15, the 7-foot freshman out of Kansas. A former high school football player. He brings that football mentality to the court, that toughness for Kentucky. There he is setting screens inside, number 15, and Orlando Antigua, the assistant coach for Kentucky, telling me the three times they went to watch him this year on recruiting trips, they were all three football games. As Goodwin misses, Cauley-Stein unable to get the subsequent rebound.
I'd like to be a quarterback going to that guy. You kidding me?
So that fade down by the end zone. And Tito said that he put a nice show on, too, during the football games. Caught a bunch of passes. Of course, Calipari was telling him, make sure he doesn't run down the middle of the field.
I don't know how many 7-foot slot receivers that there are, but
Archie Goodwin on the drive, and Goodwin fouled on the play. Goodwin had 10 points, 4 rebounds, 4 assists. Interesting that he's the only freshman to lead his team in scoring and assists, both categories difficult for freshmen, just coming in, trying to learn the nuances of the game. And boy, you know what? Pittman still in pain and discomfort. Not too happy about it either. It's the second time he's had to come out of the ball game. Stein kicks it back out. Olsen out to Harrell. Way strong. Noel with the putback. Tipped up by Goodwin.
You can see the attack that Kentucky has on the glass. I mean, there's three different players in there, and Goodwin just hung in the air a little bit longer than everybody else in the gym.
Manning out top. How important, Kara, for Marshall, we were talking about during the commercial, to at least get this to halftime within striking range still?
Well, I think it's important, and the thing that worries you about Marshall, at least on the offensive end, is Pittman not being in the game. Because between Scarver and Pittman, those are the two players that had great ability to get their own shot and at least score against Kentucky in the half quarter in transition. The rest of the guys are more complementary pieces, especially with this offense not having DeAndre Kane.
There's one of the two components you referred to, Scarver off the mark. Knocked out of bounds by Spikes, and it'll stay Kentucky basketball. Robert Goff coming into the ball game. Spikes will get a breather. We're just under 6 minutes to go here in the first half. The Thundering Herd out of Conference USA prognosticators picking them second in the conference this year. Behind Memphis, Noel inside, tough sledding, loose ball, Herd have it. Blocked by Noel. And a foul against Marshall. But good hustle at the defensive end.
Absolutely. I mean, there are times when you think you're in a three-on-one, and as a defender, you go, uh-oh. Well, if Nerlens Noel is in the three-on-one and he's the one, the three players go, uh-oh, because no one wants to take the shot. I mean, there was a guy last year in Anthony Davis here that set all kinds of records, and I think there's been unfair comparisons because Nerlens Noel is not Anthony Davis. But the one thing he has, like Anthony Davis, is fantastic timing and the ability to strike fear with his shot-blocking ability.
Goodwin with a sweet crossover and couldn't cash in. You figure Davis was a little better at the offensive end coming in?
I just think all around, Davis is probably a better player. But certainly when you look at Noel and steals, blocks, what he can do on the defensive end of the floor, they're comparable. But yes, Davis, a little more sound on the offensive end.
Well, Robert Goff with that jumper. And there's Cauley Stein raising up for the slam. He's got four. He was ranked 10th at the center position in the country by ESPNU last year in the class of 2012. Martinin continuing to struggle, and that further underscores the offensive problems for Marshall, with Pittman injured, and that's their sixth turnover.
And that's probably what's hurt Kentucky more than anything are the comparisons. You know, the fact that Anthony Davis and Nerlens Noel are compared, the fact that Ryan Harrow is compared to the bevy of point guards that John Calipari has had under his tutelage the last 5 years. They're not those guys. And this is not last year's team. And this is a team that has a lot more work to do to get to where they need to be.
Coach Cal's own words as Noel finishes strong at the rim. This is a learning curve on steroids with these newcomers, but that learning curve seems to be being ascended the right way and at the right speed right now.
You take a look at Nerlens Noel. It's about aggression towards the basket. We've seen that from Cauley Stein and Noel. Kentucky up 7.
Chris Cotter joined by Stephen Bardo coming up on the K Jewelers Halftime Report. Kansas and Ohio State as we speak in Columbus. We'll update you on how those two Final Four teams from last year are doing. And it was anything but a garden party for Syracuse at MSG. And we had some big upsets on the day. A couple of mid-majors looking good, including South Dakota and Wofford among them. Now back to Mark and Kara in Lexington.
All right, Chris, and Kentucky leading by 9, 3:43 to go here in the first half. Marshall head coach Tom Herrien having a little fun along with John Calipari. And this was Herrien a few moments ago very reluctantly, just give me that ball. And demonstrative and animated. Look at the button, Kara. It never pop. I thought it was going to pop any minute there. Is that a rip move he was demonstrating?
Yeah,
I'm not sure what it was.
He's trying to get Willie Cauley-Stein to go to the basket, you know, with aggression. And we talked about that. I mean, 4 or 5 minutes ago, there was a couple plays back to back where both of those post players for Kentucky went to the basket hard.
Wilcher and Harrow getting set to check back into the ball game for UK. Goodwin with the left-handed layup, left it short. Pittman back in the ball game for Marshall, but he has been hampered by an unknown injury. Hasn't been disclosed yet. He had to come out of the ball game twice. Let's see, Kara, if he can get back in some kind of offensive rhythm. He's their second leading scorer, a little over 14 a game. Well, drove to the bucket that time, although he couldn't finish. And a block by Cauley Stein. Tipped out of bounds by Pittman. It'll be Kentucky basketball.
You know, Archie Goodwin has really struggled the last two games offensively. And this is a young man that had to play out of position. When Ryan Harrow was not able to play, he had to play the point guard position, not his true position. Now he slides back to the two. So it's almost been learning two positions in a short period of time. And he just doesn't look as comfortable on the offensive end.
There's Harrow. He's looked comfortable shooting the ball, although that time missing. Rebounded by Spikes. Under 3 minutes to go in the first half. Marshall, a little bit of a danger zone here. Trying to keep this lead below double figures going into the locker rooms. Scarver out top. Spikes, the senior from Dillard High in Fort Lauderdale, missing right at the rim, and a foul going to be called against Tinnen. That's his second personal foul. Team's seventh foul. So Kentucky in the bonus. Here's a look at the Hawaiian Airlines Diamond Head Classic coming up from beautiful Honolulu. We go down the matchups, and University of Miami taking on Hawaii in the night game on ESPNU. Had a chance to watch the Hurricanes upset Michigan State a little bit earlier this year.
course, with Duran Scott back into the fold, that totally changes things for Jim Larranaga. Now Arizona coming off that big win against Florida.
Boy, what a finish that game was.
Yes.
That was as much a Florida meltdown, you'd have to say, wouldn't you?
Yeah, and toughness of Mark Lyons. I mean, down the stretch, he made some plays.
Well, I guess Pittman's okay, Karolas, and he raised up nicely and knocked down his ninth point of the game. Marshall back to within seven. Pittman, as I mentioned earlier, very comfortable on this floor. Played some high school title games here. Off the miss, Marshall looking to run. Scarborough had it knocked out of bounds, back tap by Mays. 1:47 to go in the half. Pittman in the corner. Took a shorter Goodwin on him, but lost the handle.
See right there, that's not a statistic for Noel, but he caused that. He went to double, tried to post up the smaller Goodwin, and Noel, just with his presence, went over to double, and as a result, Pittman turned baseline, turned it over.
Wilcher. At some point, Noel, he's got to be able to step in and knock that shot down, you think, right? Although it might not be now.
Yeah, that point might not be anytime soon. I mean,
that's going to be a foul against Scarver, his first, sending Mays to the free throw line with the bonus.
And one of the things, as a coach, you try to get your players to understand is where are their good shots? What areas of the floor? And that's another thing that John Calipari is having to do. Nerlens Noel seems to understand that around the rim is where he's going to make his money and where he can best help his team.
Mays knocked down the first foul shot, a 94% free throw shooter on the season. One man that began his journey at North Carolina State, former Horizon League Player of the Year at Wright State, and now on to Kentucky, where he provides some much needed and valuable playing experience. Nine-point lead again. Not the early blowout that some people might have thought it could have been at this point. Scarborough off the mark. Rebounded by Goff, and a foul underneath on the Wildcats. That's going to go against Archie Goodwin, his second. That sends Goff to the free throw line. Talked about Marshall last year, going 21-14, 9-7 in Conference USA. Expected to fight it out this year with Memphis for the conference title. Got to get healthy though, right, Carol?
Absolutely, and it's certainly their goal this year coming in was to earn an NCAA tournament bid, a goal that could still be achieved for them. But when you look at the fact that a talented point guard in Kareem Canty, who was going to be a key contributor for Tom Herrien this year, ruled ineligible. And then DeAndre Kane. I mean, they're down to their third and fourth point guards. And that's tough. That's tough when you're playing the non-conference schedule that has the likes of Cincinnati, West Virginia, Villanova, South Dakota State, a lot of good teams on the slate.
Coach Herrien's team, to a man, felt they were slighted last year as you take a look at some of the valuable missing pieces on that roster. They felt slighted last year. They made it to the Conference USA championship game in the tournament and did not make the NCAA tournament field, and to add insult to injury in the NIT, they had to go on the road for the first round.
Served as a lot of motivation for these players in coming into this year, and they put a lot of emphasis on this season. But DeAndre Kane, they don't know when he'll be back, but they certainly expect him back before the end of the season. He's not out for the year. He will change how they can play and the explosiveness that they have on the offensive end. And we see that they have a tough front court, and they can battle on the glass with anybody in the country.
Under a minute to play here in the first half. Okay, Marshall can't afford to leave points on the board at the free throw line. Right now, just 6 of 10. Mays with an open look. Well, they've had several of those rim out. high ball screen here for Martin. I think we're going to go for one here. 10 to go on the shot clock and the game clock. There's your go-to guy. Tried to draw contact and missed everything. Pittman incredulous as he careens to the court. Harrell with 11 points at the break, well above his season average and rounding into form as Kentucky has the lead at halftime. Right now, let's go to Chris Cotter in the studio and the K Jewelers halftime report.
Thank you, Mark. Chris Cotter here along with Stephen Bardo. It is the K Jewelers halftime report. And earlier in the day at Madison Square Garden, Syracuse and Temple, Jim Boeheim already has 900 wins under his belt, looking for another 900. Look at Khalif Wyatt here. Hits the runner in the lane for Temple. Temple was down just two in the first half.
Yeah, he's channeling his inner John Bagley on that shot.
So if Wyatt gets in the lane, and then Temple starts hitting it from the outside in the second half, up three. Michael Carter-Williams here to C.J. Fair for the three.
Yeah, C.J. Fair really balled and kept him in the game this afternoon.
Had 25 on the day. Final minute, Syracuse down one. Brandon Trish's shot goes wanting. Carter-Williams with the rebound. He can't get it to go. Wyatt with the rebound. He's eventually fouled. Wyatt would score 33 and go 15 from 15 from the line. It's the fifth straight season that the Owls have beaten the top 10 team. Welcome in studio, Chris Cotter, along with, as I mentioned, Stephen Bardo. So the Owls are coming off a loss to Canisius. Mm-hmm. You think they're going to go into Madison Square Garden against the number three team and they're going to get blown out. How were they able to win this game?
Well, first of all, in their loss to Canisius, they shot 4 of 28 from the three-point line. So they didn't want to depend on the jumpers, but they got into the lane and attacked the zone. Did an outstanding job of getting the ball to the free throw line and looking opposite, looking down to Lee on the baseline, who had a career day as well, and they found Scootie Randle on the perimeter. So Temple, a great game plan. They bounced back from a tough loss. And Syracuse, they made Michael Carter-Williams, Chris, a scorer instead of a passer. He only had 4 assists. The nation's leading assist guy was having trouble scoring the basketball this afternoon. That was a recipe for disaster for Syracuse.
Syracuse shooting the basketball only 2 of 10 from three-point range, yes. So only made those 2 buckets, and you saw one of them with C.J. Fair. Great game going on right now. Top 10 matchup, rematch of a semifinal game from last year's Final Four. Kansas and Ohio State, first half action. It's Deshaun Thomas who's going to drain a three-pointer. He can do it from all over the court, can't he?
Yeah, he can score in a phone booth. Deshaun Thomas getting busy early for the Buckeyes.
So Ohio State was down 2, and then Ben McLemore's had a great season so far.
Well, he's my favorite two-guard in the country to watch. He's just a natural.
Watch Thomas here coming off the screen on the baseline, wide open, drains this three. Ohio State up 1 at that point. And Ohio State's a complete team, though. Aaron Kraft here runs the point, you say, as well as almost anybody in the country.
Yeah, one of the best point guards in the nation, especially on the defensive end.
So Kansas with a three-point lead right now, about 15 seconds left to go in the first half. Great day for upsets and resume builders. There's a couple of mid-majors get big wins. We'll tell you who got them coming up.
This halftime report is presented by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K. You're watching ESPN's Holiday Hoops, presented by K Jewelers.
Get your game on.
Sweat dripping off the tip of my nose, blood stains all over my clothes.
Get your game on.
Ice water pouring through my veins. I'd watch. We're changing to get your game on.
Welcome back, everyone, to the SEC on ESPN Holiday Hoops, presented by K Jewelers, as Marshall takes on Kentucky from Rupp Arena here in Lexington, Kentucky. It's a 9-point game to the break as we get started here in the second half. Mark Jones courtside chopping it up with Kara Lawson. Kara, at the top of the show, we talked about this young Kentucky team being vulnerable. One guy who has been very good in the first half, Nerlens Noel.
He has. He impacted the game in a lot of ways. I loved his aggression a couple times when he caught the ball early on the block. I think this needs to be his go-to move here in the post. Just get it and use your strength and your athleticism and go around. But this is also a young man that impacts the game on the defensive end. We know about the blocks. How about the steals right in the open court in the finish? But the player of the game on the offensive end for Kentucky was point guard Ryan Harrell. And this is a young man that needs to assert himself on that end. And he's a big reason why Kentucky has 24 points in the paint in that first half because he's in attack mode. The slippery point guard was able to get in there and get double figures.
Anytime you're strong at the one and the five, up the middle, you got a great chance. And right now, Kentucky up by nine as we start the second half. Here's a look at Pittman. He got out of the gate quickly for Marshall and gets a good start here in the second half. Marshall very much the voice and the personality of the Thundering Herd. Team's second leading scorer. Cauley Stein getting the start, Kara, here in the second half. What do you make of that move by Calipari?
Well, Kentucky has struggled out of the gates in second halves all season long, and so it is not a foreign concept for John Calipari to come out with a different second half starting lineup as he did in the first half. And again, Marshall with five quick points.
That's a pretty quick timeout that Calipari forced to call as he singles out Ryan Harrow this time, his point guard, who had a spectacular first half. But Marshall getting the Wildcats' attention quickly here at the beginning of the second. Anxiety etched across the countenance of head coach John Calipari, his lead cut to just four. You go back to last April, a whirlwind of activity. It started with a national championship. And then losing a ton of players to the NBA draft. Six in all, four of them coming in the first round, led by number one pick Anthony Davis. And then expectations abound again, ranked number three in the preseason poll. And, well, they struggled. The result of their inexperience underscored by a home loss to Baylor, now in the middle of a three-game winning streak, courtesy of 21 consecutive days at home. Goodwin out of the timeout, got it punched and rejected. They've got numbers coming back. P.J. Scarborough, oh, up top, Pittman with the alley-oop. He's got 13, and it's a two-point game. Goodwin forcing another one. Boy, he really seems out of sorts, doesn't he?
He seems a shell of himself on the offensive end, and Archie Goodwin, he needs to understand that he can't be a bystander as a two-guard. With someone with his electric ability, he has to force the issue.
Stein with a sweet-looking jump hook.
That's a good bucket. That's a good possession. I mean, when those two players, that's the advantage they have is their length. When they're aggressive and assertive, making moves directly toward the basket, they've been tough to stop on the offensive end.
A whistle and foul going to go against Harrell. Trying to guard Manning. That's his first personal foul. Poythress coming into the ball game. A struggling Goodwin going to get a breather. Poythress been kind of conspicuous by his silence in this ball game.
Both of them. And you wonder, you know, the substitutions in and out. I know one was for a foul trouble, but you wonder the type of message John Calipari is sending. And, you know, Poitras didn't start the second half in their last game against Lipscomb either. I mean, those are two guys that he needs their offense and he needs their energy.
A whistle and a foul underneath against Cauley Stein. As Nigel Spikes will go to the free throw line for a pair and a chance now to come back to within two. That's Cauley Stein's second personal foul.
You know, we talked about certain players not looking comfortable on the offensive end for Kentucky. I'm not sure John Calipari is comfortable with certain combinations and knowing what buttons to push yet because he hasn't had consistent play. I mean, one night it's one guy, the next night it's another guy, and that's part of what this break, this winter break is allowing him to do, is to see what's really inside some of these kids.
Expectations abound with five new starters this year. There's a look at Wilcher on the bench. Wilcher comes off the bench, and he actually has the most accumulated minutes in a Kentucky uniform of any returning player. Three-point ball game. Harrell out top. There's Mays. Well, couldn't find the handle. Fights for it. Possession arrow in favor of the Wildcats. So it'll stay Kentucky basketball with 18 seconds to go on the shot clock. Mays off the screen. Strong. Cauley Stein hustling. He kept it alive for Poythress. Back out to Harrell. High ball screen by Noel. Harrell with the layup.
That's been one of their better plays this afternoon because it gives Harrell the opportunity to get downhill, and there he gets around the corner, and you're going to stay tight to Noel on the roll to the basket because of his ability in the air to dunk the basketball.
Oh, a bad pass by Pittman. He gave it away. 3-on-2. Harrell with the floater gets it. And the lead swells back up to 7 in a rush. Ocharian calling timeout for the Thundering Herd. And the jacket customarily now off.
Well, Ryan Harrell has been on the tack on the offensive end, and that's a great sign for Kentucky because his mentality and his ability to get into the lane, that really helps open up things for them on the offensive end, whether it's Noel rolling to the basket, Cauley Stein on an offensive putback. I think he's the key player, and I think him not being available for those few games, I think that really set them back in terms of their offensive evolution because it slid Goodwin to the point guard position, allowed him to not gain valuable reps at his normal position, which is a two-guard position. With him back, with him being aggressive, I think that bodes well for Kentucky moving forward.
Well, Harrell certainly trending in the right direction, coming off a season-high 12 points against Lipscomb in their last game. And now with 15, another season-high with the meter still running.
And by no means is Harrell a finished product. I mean, he has to be tougher. He has to learn to handle contact on both ends of the floor. He is a little slight. But his ability to get into the lane, to take a lot of pressure off of some of these other players, being a ball handler, and that helps this Kentucky team.
Pittman kicks it back out. A whistle and a foul going to be against Mays. He's grabbing him by the shorts. That's his second personal foul. One thing about Calipari, still an abundance of energy on the sidelines. It was a long summer for him. He ended up coaching the Dominican Republic national basketball team. He and Orlando Antigua and some other members of the staff, and they were down in the DR and in Las Vegas playing against the USA national team, a couple of exhibition games, the FIBA Americas tournament down in Argentina. And he was a nonstop energy, a whistle and a foul. Harrell tripped up. Always a little scary when someone rolls into your leg. Foul is going to be the third against Timmons.
Again, trying to make a post-entry pass. We saw it with Noel down there. You try and pass it to a guy at his ankles. That's not really a high percentage play. You talk about shots being high percentage play. How about passes being high percentage passes? So post-entry, I mean, you've got to get it to those big players' mitts.
That Timmons foul, that's just the first against Marshall. Kentucky with 3 so far in the second half. Poitras got his own rebound and fouled on the second attempt. There a snapshot of the effort coming from Alex Poitras.
I mean, don't you just watch Poitras and think, when is this fella going to unleash something on the opponent? I mean, just a strong physical body. And, we talk about the unreal expectations for this group because of what those freshmen did a year ago. But I think what a lot of people forget about that team a year ago is that they had Terrence Jones. They had Darius Miller, a senior. They had Deron Lamb. They had guys that had some experience, whereas this group, in large part, there's not really a ton of experience at Kentucky.
A lot of that prodigious talent, extremely young, extremely inexperienced, but right now with a 9-point lead. Goff out top. Kentucky answering with an 8-1 run after that 5-0 short sprint by the Thundering Herd. Pass by Pittman, out of bounds, off the foot of Goff. And another Marshall turnover. The 11th one of the ball game. When we come back, something that Coach Calipari is familiar with, the old one and done debate.
A one and done is a good rule. There's no rule that's absolutely perfect for everybody.
We'd all rather have what baseball has. If you go to college, you stay 3 years, that would be the best.
I think if a young man's got the opportunity to pursue a professional career, and the team is willing to draft that player, I really believe they should be able to go.
If a young man's good enough out of high school, let him go. But if he comes to college, he's got to give us 2 years. And I think there's great momentum for that rule to change to that format.
Certainly every year, one of the hot topics, especially when UK is discussed in the spotlight.
You know, I like for a player to be out of high school. I mean, I would like a player to be able to go out of high school, but I understand the coaches, some of them, and they're wanting, if they get that commitment, to have a player for at least 2 seasons. One of the things I think it devalues is the second semester of a freshman year in the classroom if you allow the one and done.
Some players take their foot off the gas a little bit, and I know there are executives on the other side of the ledger with the NBA that would like to see collegians stay a little bit longer. Well, missing that left-handed hook. For what it's worth, Damian Lillard stayed 4 years in college, and he's on pace to be the league's rookie of the year. There's Goff on the drive. Comes up short. Pittman underneath with the putback. Oh, and Porzingis. Nothing intentional there. I think he actually tried to catch him. The official is moving in to not really defuse anything, but separate the players. Hey, Porzingis was going for the old piggyback ride there.
Oh, he landed on top of him. And it looked like Pittman was just trying to get out from under Porzingis.
Yeah. That's going to be the third foul, though, on Porzingis. Pittman was trying to catch him a little bit. And he's the ball. Pittman going. He's had a rough time, Pittman has today, with struggling with a couple of injuries. He's had to leave the court a couple of different times. Second leading scorer on the team.
Oh, Elijah Pittman, I mean, he's really comfortable with Rupp Arena. He won a state championship here for Holmes High School back in 2009, so a Kentucky product. Probably grew up watching the Cats and now having an opportunity. He's been unafraid. I mean, he's been the one guy on Marshall that's come in here to Rupp and said, all right, let's bring it.
Yeah. Made a three-pointer in every game so far this year. 15 tonight. Marshall hanging around, down by just 7. Stein hands it off, and now they go inside to Nerlens Noel. An impressive jump hook off the mark. Good energy to get it back, and boy, he may not be the most refined guy offensively, Kara, but a great motor.
He has some work to do on the offensive end, but, you know, the thing that he, when he has been assertive, and, you know, I've said this before, when Cauley-Stein and Noel go to the basket and are quick with their moves, they're difficult to defend, and you see how active they are. I mean, he rebounded his own shot. It was a good-looking hook, but he stays on the attack and rebounds his own shot, and that type of effort is going to give you extra opportunities.
And well, Noel, from a very athletic background and family, he has two older brothers that play football, one at Boston College and the other one at North Carolina State, a defensive back. Knocks down the second of two, and Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers continues here on ESPN2. After this, a double dip. Missouri taking on Illinois, followed by Florida against Kansas State. That's tonight. That's all immediately at the conclusion of this game. 6 Eastern here on ESPN2, also on Watch ESPN. 8-point contest as Martin gets it over the midcourt line. Martin using the ball screen. Carver with a double dribble, yeah. That was a good call.
He's been conspicuously absent on the offensive end. Scarver with a hot start, really on the attack and transition, and has been rendered ineffective on the offensive end here in the second half.
He's one of the two prolific junior college players that Marshall brought in this year. Ethan Trinity Junior College as Wiltshire finally knocks one down. And the lead up to double digits now on his first three. See if Marshall can fight back here. Martin with the left-handed layup high off glass. They'll get another possession. A jumper by Scarver, no good.
And a foul on the play as well by Robert Goff. That's the third personal foul, fourth team foul.
That's one of my favorite plays in all of basketball, the pick and pop. And Kyle Wilcher, his strength at the offensive end, his strength in basketball is shooting the ball from beyond the arc. And he's just got a lot of confidence when he can get his feet set. Kind of had a breakout game against Lipscomb, had not shot the basketball well there in the middle stretch of the non-conference schedule.
In stark contrast to his father, Greg Wilcher, former member of the Canadian national basketball team, who was a low post player. Drive and a foul against Pittman. That's his second personal. And the foul is starting to mount up a little bit for Marshall. That's their fifth. Archie Goodwin at the free throw line for the Kentucky Wildcats had 10 points and 4 rebounds and 4 assists in their last game against Lipscomb. I mentioned along with Poitras, the only freshman in the country as a pair to average 15 points a game. Largest lead of the ball game for the Wildcats at 12. What does Marshall do here to get their offense back on track, Kara?
Well, for them to get back on track, I mean, it has to go through Scarver or Pittman. And, you know, Pittman has carried the load. I think you got to run some stuff for Scarver, look to try and get him going. But those are the two players that are going to have to bring the offense for you in the second half. The rest of the pieces are just ancillary parts.
Jameer Hanna turns it over. Here's a look at Scarver. Poitras. Reeves goes on a flare to the corner. Little two-man game with Wilcher. Mays and one. Julius Mays.
I love the decision there by Julius Mays because he understands that his outside shot has not been working this afternoon. He had the opportunity to take a look, but he decides to go right-hand drive to the middle, hard to the basket, taking the contact and finishing. It's a tough play by Mays.
That veteran leadership that you talked about a little bit earlier, a senior transfer, started his career at North Carolina State, then played at Wright State, the former Conference Player of the Year in the Horizon League. Right now working on his master's in kinesiology. Study of body movement's pretty good on that last bucket. Kentucky with its biggest lead of the game at 16. Martin and got a really nice roll and a soft touch. A long two. Kentucky looking for its eighth win of the season and its fourth in a row. Goodwin on the drive and one. Nice change of speed by the freshman.
This high pick has been good for the Kentucky guard, specifically Ryan Harrow, but also Archie Goodwin, and it gives him the ability to get downhill. And we talked about him being out of sorts on the offensive end at the two-guard position, not getting as many of these opportunities that he got early in the season when he was running the point predominantly.
Just 3 of 13 from the field. Had a chance to watch Archie Goodwin a couple of summers ago down in Orlando at the AAU Nationals and Showcase, player for the Arkansas Wings. And I'll tell you what, that Kentucky coaching staff, Kara Lawson, was front row in almost every one of his games. Four deep. Of course, he got the private jet. Helps a little bit. Goodwin completes the three-point play. He's got 11 in the ball game. 12 and a half to go. Marshall, since that great start at the start of the half, and a foul going to be called against Jared Polson. Since that great start, that 5-0 sprint, they've been largely outscored the rest of the time since. Harrell coming back in. A couple of undefeateds taking a hit today. Studio update Pass on the undefeated's remaining. Oh, what a block on the play by Goff. But Kentucky gets it back. Poitras inside. And he gets it on the putback. Timeout Marshall. It wasn't exactly pretty or pristine basketball, Kara. But they got the bucket at the end of the sequence. Kentucky just a step quicker here.
Well, it was a great individual play there by Goff and then Poitras. And this has been Marshall's undoing in the second half. It's just been their ability to not, or I should say their inability, to keep Kentucky off that offensive glass. And, you know, the rebounding flow of this game has really told the tale of the scoring. And when Marshall has been even on the glass, they've been close. And when Kentucky has asserted themselves on the offensive backboards, Kentucky's been able to pull away.
Hey, folks, unwrap a full day of NBA action on ESPN and ABC Christmas Day at noon. It starts Boston, Brooklyn, Knicks, Lakers on ABC after that, followed by a rematch of the finals. OKC and the Heat. Those two on ABC, then I'm back on ESPN. A double dip to finish the night off. With the Bulls and the Rockets, Nuggets, Clippers. NBA Christmas.
So Mike Green and Jeff Van Gundy are doing a doubleheader again.
Yeah.
But this time they don't have to go anywhere.
No.
See, I'm not impressed. They don't have to get on a plane to fly.
Not even taking a subway or a bus.
No, I mean, that's like doing an NCAA tournament.
Yeah, that's a layup. A whistle and a foul underneath. A flat top fade looking good. Back with more on the other side.
Chris Cotter in our ESPN College Basketball Studios. Cincinnati trying to remain unbeaten against Wright State. It's close though. Sheck Muja with the block. Kashmir Wright down the court. And he's going to miss, but there's his buddy, Titus Rubles, with the putback. And Cincinnati has the lead right now. 49-40, about midway through the second half. We thought it would be a classic, and it is so far. Kansas and Ohio State right now about midway through the second as well. It's a two-point Kansas lead. Hopefully we'll have a classic at the top of the hour as well. Phil Pressing, Mizzou getting set for Illinois, playing for bragging rights after Kentucky, guys.
All right, thanks a lot, guys. And you talk about one of the most improved players in the country. Going back to last year's Final Four and even before that, Jeff Withey of Kansas. It was really obvious in the national championship game against these Wildcats, but you look at where he was a year and a half ago to now.
I mean, when he was sitting on the pine behind the Morris twins and Cole Aldrich and was just, I mean, skinny. I mean, a real skinny volleyball player out of San Diego. And look at what Jeff Withey has done. He's transformed himself into an NBA player.
Here's Goodwin with NBA talent, driving and fouled on a play. That's going to be against number 23, Dede Scarver, his third personal. As the fouls start to mount up on a withering Marshall team right now, down by 19. Matthew Goodwin out of Little Rock, Arkansas, back on the free throw line. Seemingly, a little more determined to get to the bucket this half?
I think that all of them have been more aggressive. You know, Noel, Cauley Stein, and Goodwin especially. And I think those couple possessions where he ran the show when Harrell was on the bench kind of helped him with his aggressiveness and gave him a little spark on the offensive end.
Biggest lead of the ball game up to 21 now. Well, Marshall started with the first 5 points, a 3 and a 2. Since that time, 5 turnovers, really killing them. Bold shooting. Tinnen with a tough shot. And that starts the fast break, which is what they did want to see. Coach Herrien said, we cannot open up the floor for the Wildcats. That's what they did on that last sequence. The lead up to 23 now.
And this is what Kentucky needs to have a steady diet of all season long. Miss, make, run, and go. I mean, look at Poitras. Look at Goodwin. This is when they're at their best, when they're on the attack. So anytime they get the basketball, they secure the possession. They need to run it up like that. Good things will happen for the Cats.
A little over 11 minutes to go in the ballgame. 23-point lead. Coach Calipari talking about his team's ceiling. Still haven't gotten close yet. Folks, ESPN College Basketball available live anytime, anywhere on your computer, tablet, or smartphone. At WatchESPN.com and with the Watch ESPN app. And a happy holiday from all of us at ESPN to all of you at home. Another sellout crowd here in Rupp Arena. Blue, the prevailing color, as you would expect. Back to some of the comments from Calipari. That's not Blue Man Group. That's a. Is that a three?
Three goggles. Yeah, goggles up. Three goggles. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it was a Terrence Jones.
Just trying to keep up. Yeah.
All those guys last year. I'll get you updated, Mark. I got you.
Oh, I'm up on the kids. Mark loves the kids. Tell you what, we were talking about it during the break. The fans here with so much success. It's not an entitlement, but there's an atmosphere of them coming here to cheer, but of them to say, hey, guys, entertain us. Let's go. We're here to see the show. Martin out top for the Thundering Herd. Coming inside. Simmons had a tough time that time, fouled going to the bucket. A little ground and pound attack by Marshall gets them to the foul line. That's the third foul against Cauley Stein.
Well, with Kentucky, one of the things John Calipari has to be pleased with is that there has been some transfer. There has been some improvement. And, you know, we referenced the Camp Cal that's gone on the last couple weeks. And, you know, I remember being a player in college basketball and, you know, a lot of people think from the outside that preseason is the toughest time because you're trying to get into basketball shape and the coaches are putting in all the offenses and defenses. The toughest time for me was always after exams.
Really? Why?
Well, there's no students on campus. You're in practice and your coaches are fired up that you don't have any classes and you can practice at any time of the day.
Like three times a day?
Three times a day, whatever it is. And you're going at each other. You've installed a lot of your stuff in offenses and defenses. So there's a higher expectation than there is in the preseason. There's less room for error because there's less tolerance for mistakes. Early on in the season when you're implementing stuff, coaches are okay with mistakes. You get to this point in the year, they're not. And so it's tough.
There's been marked improvement by the Wildcats in this game. Off the miss, though. Here comes Marshall. Scarver on the move. The left-handed layup, no good. Tipped up, no good. And back comes Goodwin. Two on one. Great passing, and Goodwin got hung on the rim. Cauley Stein over to Harrell for the easy one. And that looks like Nigel Spikes coming up hobbling. Marshall, left leg. Hurting a bit. And
we're going to have to get Archie Goodwin some of those Eric Bledsoe pumps there. You see that? You see that from former Kentucky point guard last night with a couple highlight reel dunks.
I'm not sure that Goodwin's going to miss many more of those in his career, however long it lasts here at Kentucky, however long he decides to hang around. Martin out top. Simmons down in the block. That's where he scored last time. Just the lefty hook. And Harrell back the other way. What do you make of the point guard play by Harrell today? Goodwin with the jumper.
I would say Harrell's improved. You know, he's not where he needs to be, but I would say he's improved. And, you know, when you're a point guard, how you conduct yourself on the court, the confidence with which you display, how you comport yourself when there's pressure situations or maybe you make a mistake, that's the next step for Ryan Harrell. He has all of the physical tools, but the next step for him is just the swag that he plays with. I mean, the confidence that he has in himself and the toughness, and he has to display that on every possession.
An adjustment, of course, got all of last year to practice against Marquise Teague, who's now in the NBA. Sat out his transfer year. Poythress come out of the ball game. Of course, there's a great lineage of point guards here under Calipari in Kentucky. Oh, Boy, lots of contact underneath. And the length of Noel and Holly Stein really becoming a factor. There's Noel at the offensive end. Kept it alive. Gets on the floor and calls a timeout. And they call jump ball, actually. What, Nerlens Noel, Kara, is really quick off his feet on that second jump.
It's anticipation. Yeah. And a lot of times with block shots and with steals, it's not only anticipation and the ability to jump quickly physically, it's mentally reading the play and anticipating where that offensive player is going to be and having the physical ability to get there. I mean, he just has a fantastic feel for the game on the defensive end.
Boy, Marshall with only 13 points here in the second half. What does it say about Kentucky's defense here in the second half?
Well, I think the change, and John Calipari has done this a lot in this game, is having the 2 7-footers in at the same time. And we haven't seen a ton of that. And he said this morning, I've got to find ways to get Cauley Stein into the game more. Now, where that might compact you on the offensive end because they both don't have outside shooting ability, it makes you a devastating front court defensive team. And I think that's been a big key for Kentucky on the defensive end.
A little twin tower look for the Cats. Swing it around weak side now. Goff with a dribble handoff to Scarver. Well defended. Noel on the switch. Got a hand up, and that's a long hand. Here comes Kentucky. Goodwin fouled. And they'll go to the line for another pair. Kentucky pounding away. Getting out and running a little bit. That's the fourth foul now on Tinnen.
You know, going a little deeper into the Twin Towers and what it allows you to do. If you take a look at Cauley Stein and Nerlens Noel, one of them on a possession is normally going up to affect the shot, either block the shot or impact or alter it. Well, if there's only one of them in the game, a lot of times their man has prime position now for an offensive rebound because they've left them to go block a shot. When you have two of them in there, you can clean the glass. So it enables you to limit teams to one shot. And that's what Kentucky has done well in this second half.
Well, they've changed that last foul to Goff. That's going to be his fourth, not Tinnen. He went at the free throw line for a second. Was perfect up until then. 8.5 minutes to go. Kentucky looking for its fourth win in a row. And its biggest lead of the ball game. There's Martin. Good show and go by Tinnen. And a nice finish. And one. But a tough time today for Dennis Tinnen, a 6'8 senior from Green Bay, Wisconsin.
A nice shot fake to get Cauley Stein out of the air. And, you know, you wonder if Nerlens Noel, if he hangs in there. I mean, if he takes the contact there, if he gets the call.
Tinnen at the line.
You watch Coach Calipari coach, and he'll demonstrate during a game, Kara.
It's definitely an extended coaching box over there, isn't it? He's got a little supersized coaching box over there.
Goodwin losing the handle. Marshall with numbers coming back the other way. Timmons on the move. Oh, punching it home with a double-fisted attack. One of the rare highlights today for Tinnen. Boyfriend's had it knocked away. There's Manning on the drive. Boyfriend's cross court. Tinnen again, and better late than never. Tinnen's starting to heat up a little bit. He's got 14. Quite a nervous cheer yet, but a little bit anxious here at Rupp Arena. Points for South Side. They dump it inside to Noel. Well, whistle, foul, and one.
There's Noel, took his time and made the lefty hook. He's got 11. And a timeout on the floor with just under 7 minutes to go. Back with more after this.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by K Jewelers. Every kiss begins with K.
The aura of Rupp Arena, 25,000 people. It doesn't matter who you play, they're there. The history behind the arena and what it stands for just makes it a unique place and a place that players want to play in. We beat North Carolina, the number one team ranked in the country, and they cheered and went crazy. You don't ever storm the court because you're supposed to win at Rupp Arena.
When you think about all the great players that have played here throughout the years, the fantastic blue blood basketball lineage, and it's certainly a long list. Had that long winning streak recently snapped by Baylor, but this place one of the greatest home court advantages in all of college basketball. The balance is 57-1. Of course, Joe B. Hall enthusiasts would say, "Oh, Joe B. would have gone 58-0."
Been quite a run the last few years for John Calipari here at Kentucky.
Hurd back at the free throw line. Spikes a 48% free throw shooter. Spikes today with a season high 15 rebounds as May sits down. And Spikes slowed by a knee injury last year. He's been healthy all of this season so far. That's a big plus for the Thundering Hurd, a team missing a lot of key pieces right now. Ocher. That's his second three ball of the game. He's got six. Ocher out of Portland, Oregon, former high school All-American. Spikes hands it off. Here's Manning. Timmons, after knocking down a couple, missing, but great hustle. Out of bounds, and he had his teammate fall over him.
Well, that was a solid defensive possession by Kentucky, and one of the things we talked about improvement for them, communication on the defensive end. And we asked Kalis Moreno, I said, well, how do you teach them to communicate? He said, point to the baseline. Yeah. He said, make them run. Every time that they don't.
That'll work. Yeah, we talked about and kind of lamented the fact that this is a texting, not a talking generation that we're in the midst of. Wilcher out top and a whistle and a foul called. And, you know, getting back to the three-a-days that we mentioned a little bit earlier, it's not the three-a-day workouts. They've used that late session over the last week to attend some team bonding activities. One of them went to go see the movie Lincoln. And I'm told that because of the movie's reported slow start that there were a couple guys that might have nodded off a little bit. Came back to life in the middle of the show, though. Hey, important thing, they didn't fall asleep today on Marshall. Up by 23. Worthless at the free throw line, a 67% foul shooter. Well, almost got his hands on another rebound. He's already notched his first career double-double. 11 points and 10 boards. He's not going to stop shooting. Pittman won't. Missed everything, but they get another possession. Martin. Down low, and Spikes had it knocked away, but he was fouled by Noel. That's going to be the fourth foul on Nerlens Noel.
You know, what's interesting about Noel there, and we saw him poke the basketball away, even though he got called for the foul, but we've seen him earlier in the game do that and get the steal. And a lot of times when you're a post defender and you go for that steal, you do not have the ability to get back in front and challenge or block a shot. And that's what makes him special on the defensive end, is he can go for a steal with his arms, with his length, and you make your move, and he can still meet you at the rim and block your shot.
You get a well-deserved breather as Conley Stein comes in for him. As I mentioned, notched his first career double-double with 11 points and 10 rebounds. And you look at Noel and the way he fills up the stat sheet, Kara. Now, the one thing you can say about Calipari since his time here, he's really fostered a culture of selflessness. And you look at Anthony Davis, and number one pick in the draft last year, he took the fourth most or fifth most shots on the team last year.
And that's a great lesson. And, you know, John Calipari has used that to his players. Is this was someone that was the National Player of the Year. And yet on the offensive end, he took the fifth most shots. So you can impact the game. You can be a number one draft pick. You can gain all the accolades if you play the game the right way and don't focus on scoring all the time. Now, certainly Anthony Davis had some unique gifts, but Nerlens Noel has some of those unique gifts as well.
Nerlens Noel, the number one player, number one ranked player in the class of 2012. Out of Massachusetts. Everett Mass, and it's not like there aren't more coming this way as well. He fired up the plane here in Lexington. He's been out on the trail pretty hard. Orlando Antigua and Kenny Payne and Kyle Perry and Rod Strickland. Pittman, a tough shot. Spikes goes up strong and he goes back to the free throw line. A foul against Poitras. Poitras was Mr. Basketball in Tennessee, and here's who's coming in next year. Andrew Harrison, along with his twin brother Aaron Harrison, the number 3 and 5 ranked players. James Young committing as well. Could get more.
Yeah.
Andrew Wiggins still out there, although Florida State reported to be the leader for him, the number one player in the class of 2013. Of course, we saw Jabari Parker just a few days ago committing to Duke. Were you surprised by that? What are your thoughts on it?
I did not have a bead on what that young man was going to do, so I can't say that anything would have surprised me, but what a great catch for Mike Krzyzewski and his staff. When you look at the players that will be returning, remember Andre Dawkins is sitting out this season. He'll come back into the lineup. Rodney Hood, who was a great player for Mississippi State as a freshman a year ago, transferred to Duke and is sitting out this year. I mean, Duke, with the addition of Jabari Parker at that swing four spot, will be tough to beat next season. They're tough to beat this season.
There are 5 minutes to go now. Martin launching, rims out. And rebounded by Wilcher. That starts the fast break for Kentucky. They're pretty lethal in the open court. Holly Stein got ripped. Mays kicks it back out to Wilcher. A little floater by Wilcher, and Carly Stein has his back. Under 4.5 minutes to go, and it's all over but the post-game quotes right now. Goodwin steal. I don't think he's going to miss this dunk.
Well, the outcome might not be in doubt anymore, but the attention to detail and the improvement that John Calipari is expecting from his team, that's what's at stake here these next 4 minutes. I mean, you're playing for playing time, you're playing for continuity, you're playing to find a rhythm on both ends of the floor.
There's Martin. Pittman. Boy, he's really out of sorts here in the second half. Mays lost the handle. Didn't matter, though, as Harrell finished with the layup. Harrell with a season-high 19 points. And really rounding back into form a little bit. He really needed a game like this. Nice play on defense with the steal. Goodwin. And that's going to be a charge. Archie Goodwin with an education and anticipation. And it's all good after that.
Chris Cotter back in Bristol. You know, earlier in the day, the R&L Carriers New Orleans Bowl was awesome. But the Mako Bowl Las Vegas refuses to be outdone. Right now, Boise State with a two-point lead over UW late in the third over on ESPN. And that's Brandon Paul right there. He leads the Illini in scoring, assists, and rebounds. He's going to tip it up against Mizzou in 5 minutes over on ESPN News. And then over to ESPN2 as soon as Kara and Mark are finished in Lexington.
All right, thanks a lot, guys. And Kentucky up comfortably, although moments ago during the commercial break, if you looked at John Calipari here, is that the snapshot of coach whose team is losing or winning? Tough to tell, right? Pretty animated.
Well, he said this morning he's coaching for today, but he's also coaching for the end of the season. He wants to have his group prepared, and they have to continue to work. These are valuable possessions.
Wow, nice punch by Elijah Pittman. Eschewing the jump shot that time and taking it to the bucket. He has 17 in the ballgame. Kentucky now looking at a little three-quarter court pressure. And when you look at the SEC East, at some point, Kentucky going to have to deal with the Florida Gators.
I think there's no question Florida's a favorite in the SEC. And, you know, they have a combination of everything. I mean, they have great guard play, great experienced guard play with Rosario and Boynton and Wilbekin. But then you also look at what Murphy can do, a lot like what Kyle Wiltshire does and stress the floor, although I think he's a more complete offensive player. And then you got Yedet Young.
Yeah. Patrick Young, with the biggest set of shoulders in college basketball this year and last year. Hey, don't forget, coming up right after this one, Missouri taking on Illinois. And Brandon Paul, average almost 19 a game. It's going to start on ESPN News. You can catch it there, and then we'll join it immediately following this one. Good active hands by Boykins. Pardon me, Amayo tipped it out of bounds.
Speaking of SEC, Mizzou, along with Texas A&M, new to the SEC this year. And what a guard matchup there. Phil Pressey, Brandon Paul.
Frank Cave had a great season last year, and of course Missouri has an intriguing factor with a couple of transfers coming in. Wiltshire with the handoff. Harrell, that's going to be a blocking foul. Another whistle and a foul against Marshall. That one's against Boykins. Pretty balanced score sheet today for the Kentucky Wildcats, led by Ryan Harrell, sophomore, the transfer from North Carolina State, with 21 points. Goodwin coming on late here in the second half. And Noel with his first career double-double. Kentucky is looking at its fourth consecutive win and his eighth overall. Something for opponents to chew on. Man, I'm don't forget, coming up next, number 12 Missouri against number 10 Illinois.
Remember, another reason John Calipari coaching really hard is in 1 week's time, it's Kentucky and Louisville. And you talk about Missouri and Illinois being bragging rights, so that's bragging rights as well in the state of Kentucky.
Team on his crew going to take on Coach Cal. And it was interesting last year that the two of them kind of diffused that perceived rivalry between the two of them. Harrell going to the steal. Coming up on a minute to go here. Baseline drive. Oh, they're going to count it. Pittman. With a nice scoop shot. Tell you, he's got a pretty good motor, too. Elijah Pittman.
Well, a lot of confidence, and you have to respect his outside shooting ability if you're Alex Poitras. Shoots over 40% from three, and we saw that early in the game. And Pittman, he does have a motor, and he's been going hard, specifically on the offensive end for Marshall.
Tough day for Alex Poitras, fouling out at 9 points and nine rebounds. You can see the frustration on his face. Whitman with his, not the type of homecoming he would have scripted, but individually, Not a bad game for him. Stick around after this. Illinois against Missouri. You can catch it on news right now. Polson up court for Kentucky. Under a minute to go. Spin move by Pauly Stein off the mark. Mayo had it blocked. Wiltshire. With a spin. Came up short. That's about to do it. Marshall falling to 7-6 on the season. Kentucky up to 8-3 with their fourth straight win. Coming up next on ESPN2 Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers, Missouri, Illinois. Goodbye from Rupp Arena in Lexington. Right now we send it to Dave Fleming and Jimmy Dykes. Guys.